Hello everyone and welcome to my review of Saving Mr. Banks. Now before I begin my review, I want to say two things. The first is I only look at Saving Mr. Banks as a film on its own merits, so you won't see me compare it to Mary Poppins, seeing as it's based on the early production stages of Mary Poppins. The second is this review was requested by JamesWC95. Now that said, let's talk about the film, shall we? Now the plot takes place in 1961 where we see the author of Mary Poppins, P.L. Travers, played by Emma Thompson, who Walt Disney has been trying to get the rights to make a film adaptation for the past 20-ish years, even to the point of accepting the conditions of no animation and the script must be approved by her. So she travels from London to Los Angeles to head into Walt Disney Studios, where she not only meets one of the scriptwriters, Don DeGrady, but also the songwriters, Richard and Robert, also known as Dick and Bob, or simply the Sherman Brothers, and this is where we see Walt Disney, played by Tom Hanks, who promised that Mary Poppins would not only make his kids, but all kids and all adults happy as well. But of course, she is difficult to work with because Mary Poppins is her creation. And as the film progresses, we see flashbacks where we see her real life, where the story of Mary Poppins comes from. From that point on, it shows the pre-production of the film adaptation of Mary Poppins, and how difficult P.L. Travers was to work with behind the scenes, where they tried to compromise to make the project work, and as they say, the rest is history. That's all the plot mentions, so now it's time for me to say what I liked about Saving Mr. Banks, what I did not like about Saving Mr. Banks, some trivia, my overall opinion on the film. Okay, so what did I like about Saving Mr. Banks? The acting is wonderful. Emma Thompson I thought was outstanding as P.L. Travers, and that I found the dilemma she has in giving the rights to Disney believable, since she's worried they're going to Disney-fy her baby or creation. Tom Hanks was excellent as Walt Disney, not just because he looked the part so much as kind of frightening, but also because he absolutely nailed the charming showmanship and or businessman of Disney that gets what he wants. However, at the same time, delivering the emotional scenes, like when he shows how he relates to P.L. Travers' situation, when he wouldn't sell Mickey Mouse to a bigger businessman, even when he had nothing because, as he said it, the mouse was family. There are other people to mention, like Paul Giamatti's P.L. Travers' chauffeur, Ralph, Colin Farrell's P.L. Travers' alcoholic yet loving father, Travers Goff, Bradley Whitford as Don DeGrady, and even B.J. Novak and Jason Schwartzman as the Sherman Brothers, but really, aside from saying they were overall really good, I don't have a lot left to say about the acting that wouldn't be a repeat of what I've already said about the main leads. The score by Thomas Newman, I could see why it was nominated for an Oscar because it was outstanding. One example I think was a very nice touch was in certain parts, most notably the beginning of the film, they have a piano rendition of the Academy Award winning song from Mary Poppins, Chim Chim Cheree. Plus I felt it fit perfectly with the lighthearted tone that this movie was going for. The production values such as costume design, makeup, etc., I don't have a lot to say other than it was well done. Mostly because they do a good job of showing the differences between 1906 and 1961. I also felt the direction by John Lee Hancock was overall pretty good. One example I thought was well done was how they transitioned the flashbacks with the present time. Like they show P.L. Travers on a train where she's moving to a different part of Australia, and it goes from the smoke of the train to the clouds that the plane is going through when she is traveling from London to Los Angeles. And while there is something I'll mention later in the cons regarding the flashbacks, I thought the film was for the most part reasonably paced. Lastly, the overall story is really well done. Sure, there were changes from what I heard actually happened behind the scenes, like from what I understand, Walt Disney never actually traveled to London to visit P.L. Travers at her home, and the song Let's Go Fly, Kite was never the song that won P.L. Travers over, and there was actually one thing in that regard I'll bring up later in the cons, but still, this was really adult for Disney as they briefly show Walt Disney not only smoking, but also drinking, swearing, and even show him as being a bit backstabbing, like when he doesn't invite P.L. Travers to the premiere of Mary Poppins, and I do commend Disney for being honest in that regard. Plus, there aren't a lot of films that show the development of a film, which I found to be really interesting to see how both sides were trying to compromise to make this project work, as well as witness the Battle of the Eagles, where Walt Disney wants it one way, and P.L. Travers wants it another way. It's just, there are so many aspects about this film that I think were not only really well done, but I found to be fascinating as well. So while there are some very good things about Saving Mr. Banks, what did I not like about Saving Mr. Banks? Well, I do have two complaints, but both are pretty minor in that they didn't ruin the viewing experience for me, and they're more personal nitpicks to me. My first complaint is, while the flashbacks were well done and Colin Farrell was great as P.L. Travers' father, I will admit at times it feels like they go on for a bit too long. What I mean by that is sometimes it felt like the flashbacks took up more of the film than I thought was really necessary, and in some instances, I felt could have been trimmed just a little bit. But again, I found this complaint to be minor because the flashbacks were still well done. My second complaint is they do kind of make it look like P.L. Travers was reacting to her creation being brought to the big screen in a positive way, despite the fact we all know what the real P.L. Travers really thought of the film adaptation of Mary Poppins, which is she despised it. And I know a lot of film adaptations based on true stories tend to change a few details, but this one I felt they either really should not have changed it, or at the very least made it more clear in what they're trying to convey. But like I said, these complaints are really minor or more nitpicks to me because they didn't ruin my viewing experience, and I felt the pros far outweighed the cons because what worked in this film really worked. Now for some trivia. As I mentioned earlier, Saving Mr. Banks was nominated for the Academy Award for Best Original Score along with The Book Thief, Philomena, and Her, but it lost to Gravity, and Emma Thompson was nominated for a Golden Globe for Best Actress Drama, but lost to Cate Blanchett for her performance in Blue Jasmine. From what I gather, Walt Disney tried to get the rights to make a film adaptation of Mary Poppins as early as 1938, but year after year was rejected until he got the rights in 1961. The reason why P.L. Travers refused to give him the rights was because she was disgusted with how Hollywood was doing book-to-film adaptations at the time, and she felt a film version of her books would not do any justice to her creations. To prepare for his role, Tom Hanks made several visits to the Walt Disney Family Museum in San Francisco, California, as well as interviewed some of Walt Disney's relatives, including his only surviving daughter at the time, Diane Disney Miller. And what makes things a bit interesting here was Tom Hanks was 55 when they began filming, whereas Walt Disney was 5 years younger when he began work on Mary Poppins. This was the first score Thomas Newman did for a live-action film by the Walt Disney Company, as he previously did the score for Disney's subsidiary, Disney Pixar's Academy Award-winning films Finding Nemo and WALL-E. This was the first film that John Schwartzman did the cinematography for one of John Lee Hancock's films since The Rookie 11 years earlier, and what makes things even more interesting is that he's the half-brother of Jason Schwartzman, who played Richard Sherman in the film. The director of the film is John Lee Hancock, who also directed The Rookie, the Academy Award-winning film The Blind Side, and yes, even the notorious box office bomb The Alamo. Some of the other roles the cast did includes Tom Hanks, who you might know as Woody from the Toy Story trilogy, Andrew Beckett from Philadelphia, which he won the Oscar for Best Actor, Forrest Gump from, well, Forrest Gump, where he again won the Oscar for Best Actor, Captain Richard Phillips from Captain Phillips, where he was nominated for the Oscar for Best Actor, Captain John H. Miller from Saving Private Ryan, where he was again nominated for the Oscar for Best Actor. The list goes on and on with other roles he did. Emma Thompson, who also played Margaret Schlegel from Howard's End, where she won the Academy Award for Best Actress. Eleanor Dashwood from the 1995 film adaptation of Sense and Sensibility, where not only was she nominated for the Oscar for Best Actress, but she won the Oscar for Best Adapted Screenplay. Professor Sybil Trelawney from the Harry Potter franchise. Queen Eleanor from Pixar's Academy Award-winning film Brave. And Nanny McPhee from not only the 2005 film adaptation of Nanny McPhee, but also his 2010-2011 sequel, Nanny McPhee Returns, also known as Nanny McPhee and the Big Bang in the UK. Colin Farrell, who also played Ray from In Burgess, where he was nominated for a Golden Globe for Best Actor, Musical, or Comedy. Bobby Pellet from Horrible Bosses. Danny Whitmer from Steven Spielberg's 2002 film adaptation of Minority Report. And yes, he was even not only Alexander the Great from Oliver Stone's Alexander, but also Bullseye from the 2003 film version of Daredevil. Paul Giamatti, who you might know as Henry Pekar from the Academy Award-nominated film American Splendor, Miles Raymond from the 2004 Academy Award-winning film adaptation of Sideways, Joel Gould from Cinderella Man, where he was nominated for the Oscar for Best Supporting Actor, and he was even the Rhino from The Amazing Spider-Man 2, and he was announced to reprise his role in The Amazing Spider-Man 3. Last, we have Jason Schwartzman, who also played King Louis XVI from Marie Antoinette, Ash Fox from the 2009 Academy Award-nominated film adaptation of Fantastic Mr. Fox, Gideon from the 2010 film adaptation of Scott Pilgrim vs. the World, and Cousin Ben from the Academy Award-nominated film Moonrise Kingdom. Overall, while Saving Mr. Banks is lighthearted and sentimental to a fault, it is still a really well-done biopic about how Walt Disney got the rights to make a film adaptation of Mary Poppins and what happened during the development of the film. It was really well-acted, the score was really well-done and fit with the tone of the movie, with the exception of some of the flashbacks, it was reasonably paced, it was quite well-directed, and the overall story I felt was not only well done, but I also commend them for being, for the most part, honest about what happened behind the scenes and for how adult it is. And just overall, I felt Saving Mr. Banks is a well-put-together film, and I definitely recommend it. I give Saving Mr. Banks 3 stars out of 4 and an 8 out of 10. So that's my review of Saving Mr. Banks. If you want to express your opinion on this film, you're more than welcome to, but please be mature about it. Any bashing and or personal attacks on anyone will be removed on the spot and will result in a block. And believe me, that is the absolute last thing I want to do to anyone. So that's my review of Saving Mr. Banks. I hope you all have a very nice day, and not only that, but till next time as I take another look at a film franchise that is almost 3 years in the making.